My name's Josh. This is All Things Secured, and I am excited to bring along Andy from the Secure Dad. Andy, thank you so much for joining us.
Hey, thank you for the opportunity. I'm really looking forward to it. It's amazing to see where everybody is joining us from today.
I know, right? It's so much fun. Andy, why don't you give us a little bit of kind of an introduction as to what your primary focus is, because maybe people who are mostly YouTube-based haven't heard much about you, but you got a pretty good podcast going. When right. We're talking about the Secure Dad, what exactly does that mean?
So the Secure Dad is a brand that I created because, you know, myself, I'm a dad. You know, I've been married for 16 years, a dad for 11. And I started to realize that there was a lot of people like me who were very concerned about their family's safety. And so I started to blog about home security. That turned into a home security book that ended up being an Amazon bestseller. And then I started a podcast because everybody was like, oh, you've got to start a podcast. And I was like, oh, I don't know. So now I'm like 260 some odd podcasts into the show. Absolutely love it. One of my favorite guests on the show is a guy by the name of Josh Summers. He was just on back in January. So if you want to go check out that episode, please do. Josh is always great to talk to. But when looking at family safety, I started to realize it's more than home security, because you got to protect your family at home. You've got to protect them in public. And most importantly, now you got to protect them online. And so that's kind of where the Secure Dad is. A lot of people will say, hey, Andy, you've really got to like niche down and talk about only one of these things. But I can't, because every time I, you know, pick up my phone and I check out X or something like that, there's a new threat to kids and there's a new threat to families. And I can't let that go. So I am all about the holistic approach of protecting your family everywhere that they are. I've been doing this since 2016. And I absolutely love it. It's my passion.
Yeah, that's awesome. Well, I think one of the reasons why I wanted to bring you on for this particular episode is because a lot of what I focus on and what I've been talking about for a number of years now is mostly digital, right? We're talking about software and ways that we increase our security and really nail down our privacy in the digital world. But I feel like, you know, you talked about the fact that it, both online and in the physical world, but I know a lot of what you do kind of deals with the physical world. And so I thought it'd be fun to kind of do a little show and tell. And for those of you who are watching, I am like, it's not that Andy and I have the only or the best pieces of security tech out there. As a matter of fact, I'd say I'm pretty bad at that. But I did want to show you what I do have. And if you've got other ideas, other things that you think would be good additions, please feel free, put them in the comments, or as you're watching along, please leave questions, and we'll leave some time at the end to answer those questions. So Andy, we didn't talk about beforehand what things we were going to be showing. So I've got some stuff here in front of me that I'm pretty sure you may have never seen before.
Okay.
Some of it you have seen before. A lot of it you have. But there are, I have at least one thing that that I got that's kind of, most people don't see this type of thing. I didn't know. Do you want to start first or do you want me to go?
No, I'm very curious at this point. I want to see you go first at this time.
Okay. First of all, by the way, Jacob, good to have you back. Better late than never. From Australia, we got some other people coming in from Australia. We got people all over the world that are joining this live stream, and it's a lot of fun. Okay, here's what I'm going to show you the back of it. Okay, this looks like something you've seen before.
Yes.
And I know that for most people, they go, "Oh yeah, I know exactly what that is." You don't know what this is. My guess is you don't. I get a lot of people, and mind you, a lot of people in my audience vary in the amount or the level of security that they want, right? And I recognize that. I think I don't get in arguments. People leave comments on my videos and on Twitter, like really getting angry at me. My favorite one was a recent one. You cannot recommend a password manager that hosts in the cloud. Like that's just the dumbest thing ever. It's like, okay, well, I get where you're coming from. I understand, but that's just a different threat model, right?
Right.
I'm okay putting my passwords up in the cloud because I believe that it is a well encrypted file, and I'm okay with that. Plus I go through a couple extra measures so that even if that was somehow compromised, I'm not that concerned about it. However, I do know that there are some people that are really, really worried about certain things. And if that is you, if you're like, no, there's no way, I'm very, very cautious about where I put my passwords. This is something I got from a company called OnlyKey. So this OnlyKey I'm sure this exists in other forms. I haven't seen it anywhere else. This is essentially a physical password manager. So you can see it's got six buttons and they're actually labeled 1 through 6. I don't know it's all out of, out of focus, but I can assign, I don't remember exactly how many, I think it's more than 6, but I can assign passwords to each of these. So when I plug Very it in cool. and I press that, it acts like a keyboard and gotcha. It will actually type it all out. So the only time this ever is, it's ever exposed to the internet or anything like that is when it's actually plugged in. Which gotcha. I find really interesting. So then, mm-hmm. This is my physical password manager. The problem is if you lose this thing, hopefully you've got a backup.
You've got a backup somewhere. Right.
Exactly.
I like that.
But yeah, so you're not keeping it on your computer. You're not keeping it in the cloud. It is a physical password manager. However, it doesn't store more than, I want to say it's more than 6. Maybe it's like 12 or 15 or something like that, but you can actually store your passwords on the physical key. So yeah, that's my first one. What do you think?
Oh, I like that. I think it's good because it's you could physically control the device. You can physically control where it is. You choose when it happens. Obviously, you're going to want to put that in a safe place in your house to make sure that nobody else gets their hands on it. But I mean, I think, there comes a time in passwords where it's like, do I rather just is there more of a threat online or is there more of a threat in my personal home? When that sort of thing happens. So yeah, I think that's a great idea.
Yeah. I think it is one of those things, however, and this actually goes through my head. My second device that I'll show you after you go addresses this as well. Part of what goes through my head is, okay, if I were to pass away, how easy would it be for my wife or any of my loved ones or friends to be able to now get access to the things that they need to get access to. And the reality is if I stored passwords on this thing, there's no way my wife's going to figure that out. I barely remember how to use this,
Right. So, yeah. Well, it protects you from her.
Yep. All right. We got more people live in Australia. That's awesome. And we got somebody saying, and it's so true. Marauders World says anything online is hackable. Yes. Honestly, I would say anything. There's nothing that is 100% secure, 100% foolproof. Just always keep that in mind. All right.
Yes, Andy. Very good. All right. So my first product that I want to show you, this is a fairly well-known brand, and I absolutely love their stuff. This is a Faraday sleeve from Silent. And Silent is a fantastic company that makes Faraday solutions in all shapes and sizes. I have one of these. It's big enough for my laptop. I've actually got like the 5-liter Faraday bag. And what this does, if you're not, I'm imagining you guys are familiar with the Faraday sleeve and what it does, but this is going to block any signals coming and going from an electronic device. And so what I like these for is using this just to drop off the grid for a little bit. Like I was born in the 1980s and companies used to not know where we were all the time. And that was kind of nice, like your friends and family knew where you were, but Walmart didn't know. And that was fine. The world was okay back then. So this is one of those things that helps me reclaim my privacy and my safety when I don't want to be tracked. And I'm sure we're going to be talking about tracking later. But another one of the reasons, this is the small one. They make bigger ones for phones. And again, like I said, I have a laptop and a carry bag. But this one is actually for your car key fob. There are relay attacks that can happen, especially I think BMWs were susceptible to this for a while, where criminals could come into your driveway if your car was parked outside. They would use this mesh net antenna. And they would hold it up and try to point it at where they thought your key fob was in the house. And so it would take that RFID signal, transfer it to the antenna, and that antenna would run to a laptop, which would run some sort of an algorithm and code to try to open the doors to the BMW and start the car. And from there, the criminals would get in the car and they would drive off, and they would reprogram the car later because they had already faked all the qualifications necessary to start the car and drive off. So if you have a high-end car, which I do not, this would be a good solution for you to put your, you know, your BMW key fob in here so that, you know, when you go out in the morning, your car is still there.
Yeah. I mean, I've for my three BMWs that I keep here, I have, you know, a Faraday bag right. for each one of them.
You can get a bigger Faraday bag if you like.
Yeah, I definitely have. I have one of those. I brought it on my trip to Europe. Gosh, it was back in August of last year. And what I found is I feel like it's easier. And you tell me what you think here. I feel like it's easier to use a Faraday bag in your everyday life. Like when you kind of have a schedule and you know, where things are, you know, where you're going to be and when you can not need to be in, you know, communication with people. When I was traveling and I had to use it to, you know, get an Uber, I had to search for things. Like I would put it in the sleeve, and then 5 minutes later, I'm like, oh, dang it. I need to get it. And then I'd pull it out. And I had, it was an interesting time to say the least, but it didn't, like, I find the Faraday bag to be incredibly useful, in like my home setting, but it was very hard for me to use when I was out traveling.
Right. And I think there's also times like you talk about going through airports and stuff like that. Unfortunately, criminals carry the sniffers with them, and they are going to try to get, by the way, Silent also makes, and I don't have my wallet on me, but they make cards that go in your wallet that deflect that sort of stuff, so that if somebody bumps into your pocket with one of these sniffers, they can't get the number off of your credit card from the RFID chip. So just another thing there for you.
Andy, actually anybody who's listening, I'm not going to name the company name just because I don't know much about them yet, and I haven't actually tested the product, but I'm in communication with a company that is making a device that it's not a Faraday bag, but it sits, like, let's say on your table. And if you put your, like, you can then put everyone, the two people that are meeting, put their phone on, and somehow, whether it's using ultrasonic or whatnot, it stops the phone from being able to hear. So it doesn't stop any of the communication. So, I mean, I've thought about that. I was like, oh, that would be interesting where, you know, if I'm on a date with my wife or if I'm on a meeting, you know, and we're both there and I don't necessarily want my phone to always be listening, I could bring a Faraday bag, and that's kind of awkward to put it in there. Maybe I still need to be able to watch my phone. And this would be something different. So I'm trying to get a hold of a test unit. I'll let you know if
that sounds great.
Get anything like that. All right, man, we're moving along. I love that. All right. Faraday bag is great. Thank you. Okay, this is something I showed off in. I tend to go small here, obviously. I showed this off. It was a video from a couple of years ago now, but this is an encrypted USB drive. And it's one of those, Ageas is the one that I bought it from. And I think the company is now called Acorn or Apricorn or something like that. Someone asked in the comments if we can leave links to all this stuff. Yes, I'll put links, you know, after the video's over, I'll put links to all this stuff. But essentially what this is it's an encrypted drive that I can use when I plug it in. I've set a password. And once that password is input, then the drive gives you access to all the data that's on here.
Very good.
Very inconvenient if you're using this for files that you use often, right? And it's battery operated. So like right now, I haven't plugged it in a while. So I would have to plug it in and keep it plugged in for a bit before it would actually work, because it still needs to charge a little bit of the battery. I think it's similar to an iron key. I see someone else talking about that, but I'm going off of memory here. I don't remember exactly what the iron key is. But essentially, I mean, they've got all sorts of sizes. This is the 8 gigabyte, but I can store, you know, the files, like I store my death file on here, essentially. So my wife knows the password to this thing. And if something were to happen to me, this has like a backup of all our passwords and in, you know, basically in an unencrypted form once you get into here, because I want her to just be able to access it if for some reason she can't get into 1Password. It's got all the information related to my business, you know, and so that she could pass that along to whoever needs to. But this right here, if you tried to break in, you can't, to my understanding, I don't understand all the, everything that goes behind it, but you can't just go in and bypass all of the password you've got here. And then if you input the password incorrectly 10 times, it wipes it. It goes through and just wipes the drive completely. Gotcha. So there is, and if I remember right, I think on some of the newer ones, you actually have a code that goes through and wipes it the first time. So if somebody forces you to try to open it up, you can do it and it will open, and then it will show that there's nothing on there because it just went through and wiped everything. This to me is honestly, it's kind of one of those overkill things. I think there's better ways for my wife to be able to find the things that I need her to find. But still, I thought it was really interesting. And if there's things that you don't want people to have access to, then this is one way that you can keep them from getting access to it.
Very cool. I think a lot of people don't consider, you know, I know all this information and I have it, but what happens the day that, you know, you're sick and that somebody else needs to access that information? I like the forethought that you're putting into that, because that's going to be a bad situation that you may not be able to physically get to a computer to log on to something, and that you've got the opportunity to, for a family member to come along and help you like that is good.
Yeah. Exactly. All right. Well, that's my second one. Go for it,
Andy. Okay. So the second one, this is actually a home security thing. So I'm going to switch it up here. So this is called a Fliplok, and this is just the box because the actual Fliplok is installed on my front door with four huge screws that I can't bring up here. So what the Fliplok is, it is a secondary lock that you put on the inside of your door. If your door swings to the inside towards you, this aluminum all metal lock switches over and drops down into place, and it provides 1,300 pounds of pressure of protection against your house. Very commonly in the United States, if somebody wants to break into your home, it's usually a kick-in style attack that somebody does. They're not going to take the time to pick your lock, that sort of thing. They're just going to try to use their feet to kick through your door, and the Fliplok can prevent that from happening. And so that's what I love about this thing. It is easy to activate if it's open, and if you need to deactivate it to leave through your front door, it opens in less than a second, and then it drops in place in about a second. So if there is the event that you have it locked, and let's say unfortunately there's a fire in your home and you need to escape quickly, all you have to do is pick it up and just flip it out of the way and open your door, and you are good to go. So that's one of the things that I like about fortifying your front door, is you need to make smart upgrades to the front door. That is still, it's not going to make your door a brick wall. It is something that you can still use in order to protect your door, but also be able to still use it in an emergency so that you can get out of your home if the opportunity arises. So one of the things that I tell people with their front doors, you can't over fortify it, because one, you don't want your house to feel like a prison, because the people inside are not going to appreciate that. But then also, you know, in the event that you do need somebody to leave quickly, that sort of thing, this will open up quickly. Also, children can use this. I think it's ADA compliant. So people in like wheelchairs and that sort of thing can reach the lock and open it up. And really, it can be opened by anybody. As long as you have like, you know, two fingers and can open it up, you're good to go. You can activate it and then you can unlock it as well. So this is a great device from Houston, Texas. The Rieger family did this. So they were a husband and wife team, and they were thinking about, hey, you know, our kids are growing up and they're moving out, so how do we help them stay safe while they're not in our home anymore? And that's what led to this. And I absolutely love that story. It's a phenomenal product. There is one on my door right now, and I think they should be on every door of everybody who wants one. So it's Fliplok.
How much do they run?
Right now, between $50 and $60. If you do have a door that swings outward, like that would go out towards the sidewalk, towards the road, they have a solution for that. And they also have a really cool solution for classrooms and schools as well. So just a great, great company all the way around. If you go
I'm guessing that,
Go ahead.
Sorry, go for it. No, no, no.
I was going to say, if you go to thesecuredad.com/resources, there's a link to that there. If you use code SecureDad, you get 20% off of your order there. So that's just a good place to go to see a lot of the things that I trust in my everyday life.
Yeah, awesome. So is that then something you would install at like kid height then so that they could get out?
I would, yes. The ideal placement for it is probably about an inch above your deadbolt, because when somebody tries to kick in the door, that's generally where they're going to kick, because they're trying to break the strike plate that's in the door frame of the door. And so that's what they're trying to do. So if you put it right there, it's going to provide the maximum amount of protection for you. Great question.
Interesting. Yeah, I've seen, like, they've got these things that you can travel with. I don't know if it's the same, but you know, when you're in a hotel room,
right,
that you can set up that seems similar to that. But yeah, interesting.
Yeah.
All right. I'll go next. Actually, you know what? I'm going to go a little bit bigger this time. People who have watched my channel, or at least the travel security thing that I did, know how much I love this. I actually got a new one. Here, I'm going to put it just on me, Andy. So.
Sure.
People can see this, but this is my backpack by PacSafe. PacSafe makes a really good backpack. Like, you know, there's probably lots of great secure backpacks. The reason I love PacSafe, like, it's, I don't know if it's easy for you to see, but, you can easily like lock the zipper so that it makes it really hard for somebody to try to go in and unzip. I've got a lock here on the top. I'm trying to see if I can make this as visible as possible. And then even on the inside, I've got the ability to, like, when I put my passport in here, there's an RFID, like a slot or a pocket where I can slip that in. And now anything that's in there, even if it's my wallet or my passport, you can't scan using the RFID. So it takes and it blocks all of that. It's also slash resistant. And I heard somebody, I think it was somebody in my comments of one of my videos, was like, all right, if we're worried about someone coming at you with a knife, I think your backpack's the least of your worries. But it is interesting, because I have heard of, like, they'll take and they'll just, like, you know, slash through and then try to take whatever's inside. I haven't obviously had that happen to me, but they have what they call an exomesh on these things that keeps that from being a threat. So, you know, it's just this, I think, a mesh wiring that makes it really difficult to just slash through. So PacSafe, the backpacks aren't necessarily the cheapest, obviously, but they are, it's a really comfortable backpack. This is my second one. The first one, if you want to see, is in the video that I did, I'll link to later. I'll have that in the description of this video, but it is for the things that I use when I travel. And this backpack is on me. Like, if you were to just see me driving around on my motorcycle here, you're probably going to see me with that backpack on. And yeah, I love it. It's one of my favorites.
I want to see you on a motorcycle. I want to see that happen.
Really?
Yeah.
I mean, my cool factor goes up at least 2 times whenever I'm on a motorcycle. My wife isn't necessarily big on me getting a truck. You know, I'm from Texas, so that's like that just kills my manhood in some way. And so I try to make up for it by having a motorcycle.
Yes. Very good.
Oh, man. All right, Andy. Why don't we pause for a second? Sure. This would be a really good time to bring up the fact that you and I both use one a particular product called DeleteMe. And I know it they've been very kind to even sponsor a video where we're highlighting a lot of different products. But I think you and I have just been going back and forth. But the one thing we have in common, one of many things, but one thing that we have in common is that both of us use and have used DeleteMe for a while. And for those of you who don't know, there are a lot of data brokers on the internet right now that their whole job is to scrape information from so many different places. And then their business model is selling that information. And that could be anything from your name and email address to your phone number, your home address, any legal court documents. The list really goes on and on. And what DeleteMe does is it goes in and it erases you essentially from the internet. It goes in and they have a list of data brokers that they go in and they get your stuff removed. And so I've been using it for a little while. Andy, you've had experience with them for what, about a year, 2 years now?
Oh, I've been a client of theirs since 2018. Wow. Longer than me.
Okay.
Yeah. So yeah, they're a phenomenal company. Once I discovered what a data broker was, it was like, oh, this is going to be the thing that keeps me up at night, that anybody can just go buy my personal information and do whatever they want to with it. So it was, I want to test this out. I want to see how it works. And then I want to bring my wife on and see how it goes. And so I really enjoyed it because I went out, me being me, and tested to see if DeleteMe was actually doing what they said they were doing. Are they actually deleting me from these sites? And they actually are, which is really good. And one of the things that I like about DeleteMe over some of the other places that I've researched is they're actually going out and hunting for your information. They're searching for it like all the time. So other companies will just kind of send out on blast, like some of the data brokers that are likely to have your information. DeleteMe actually finds your information and then they go through the process of deleting it right there. So I have appreciated DeleteMe because there have been times where DeleteMe has done all this great work in taking my data off of the internet. And then I refinanced my house and I flooded the market again with all of my data after DeleteMe had done all this work for a very long time. And so all of a sudden my information starts cropping up again in all these, you know, data broker sites, and DeleteMe has to go back along and delete it all behind me. So I like it because they go out and they take care of the initial stuff that's there, but they also continue to look after you after you become a client. It's not like a one and done thing. They're always out there. They always have your back.
Exactly. And we had a question, how does it work? Do they use AI to find our data? And I also had somebody ask about it, comparing it to another one. I have actually compared to a number of them. I hadn't heard the one that some, you know, the commenter put in there. And, you know, I've used DeleteMe. And so honestly, like sometimes the incumbent just has a little bit of a bias for me. But every time I have compared, I come out really happy that I'm using DeleteMe. They don't, I'm sure there's some AI involved, but the thing is that they've got a list of data brokers that they use. And there's a difference between the way DeleteMe does it and what I've seen elsewhere. And the difference is that DeleteMe, you give them your information. And mind you, I know that there's a lot of people that go, whoa, you give them your information. Right. Well, yeah, it's information that's already out there on the internet with these data brokers. I'm not giving them my social security number. I'm not giving them, my financial or my, any of that very, very sensitive data. We're talking about the personal information, like your name, your birthday, your phone number, address, and all that stuff. And then it goes and searches for that information online. And when it finds it, that's when they go out and make requests on your behalf to take that down. I know of others that actually take your information, and I received an email from a competitor of theirs. I'm not trying to name names here, but where that competitor takes your information and sends that information to all of these data brokers and says, hey, if you have this information, if there's a match, delete it. It's like, what are you doing? That actual one of those companies emailed me and said, just so you know, now that we have your data, we have to keep it for X number of days and delete it. And it was like, oh my gosh, this is ridiculous. And so again, it just kind of goes back to the way that they operate actually makes a difference. And that's one of the reasons why I've liked this.
Right. And I've actually gotten to interview Rob Chevelle, who is the one of the co-founders of Bean and DeleteMe. And he is a privacy advocate. He is out there every day trying to do everything that he can to help people regain control of their privacy. So it really starts at the top there.
Yeah. So if you guys want to go, you can go to joindeleteme.com/allthingssecured, or you can just use the code ATS. You'll get 20% off. I know that Andy has his own referral code that you're welcome to use if you're part of his audience. So it's something we both use and we both enjoy. So we're grateful. I'm grateful for them sponsoring this video. It makes stuff like this possible and a lot of fun. So that, I've shown you my backpack. Andy, I think it is your turn. What do you got for us?
Sure. So this is a book that I'm going to hold up here. It's a very big book.
Yeah.
So this is the theory of HBPRNA. And what that stands for is human behavior, pattern recognition, and analysis. So in simple layman's terms, and something that you might have heard as a buzzword, situational awareness, this is a manual that has been written by two of the smartest people in the world. The guy who actually created the terminology situational awareness, Greg Williams, he's one of the co-authors of this book. Brian Marin, his partner at Arcadia Cognorati, is the other. And these guys have taken the science of understanding why people do things at certain times in certain environments with stressors. And they break it down into chunks that the average person like me can understand. What they have done, the curriculum that they have created is taught it's taught around the world. For just about every large country government has learned from them either directly or indirectly. And these guys have helped me to understand how I can better protect myself in public by understanding how people behave. A lot of times people will try to say, oh, just look for this little piece of body language. And nonverbal communication is very important. Please don't get me wrong. But that's not necessarily right, because you have to consider the context and the environment in which the action happened. These guys help you understand that sort of thing. They like to talk about the environments that you go into, the cues, you know, what types of places you are. Just because one place is great at 8 a.m. doesn't mean it's going to be great at 8 p.m. What's the difference? What has changed? One of the things that they talk about a lot is it is not how somebody looks that is going to be an issue. Their how somebody looks doesn't matter. Their ethnicity and nothing of that matters. It's their behavior, because pretty much humans all operate pretty much the same way. And once you understand how human behavior works, you can begin to understand, one, how you think and feel, and then how to understand how people are moving around you and interacting and that sort of thing. So it's absolutely fascinating. It is my passion. They have a podcast. I've trained with these guys for 3 days, an intensive 24-hour course. Amazing work that these guys do.
You're now stepping into kind of that, like you said, that situational awareness kind of world, where I've been through that training as well before, you know, I moved to a different country, and it is a little bit like, it's a little bit terrifying. Part of it is I don't necessarily want to live my life like always, you know, looking over my shoulder. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, that's not what I'm assuming they're even talking about. It's more just being aware. One of the things that I always do, Andy, that kind of stemmed from these type of conversations or those type of books or trainings or stuff, is when I go and sit down in a restaurant or a cafe, mm-hmm. like I'm very oddly strategic about where I sit, right? Mm-hmm. Like I want to be able to, I don't want people to be able to be behind me, you know? And so I'm going to be against a wall. I want to be able to see the doors and I want to be able to get to them. And, you know, it feels very Jason Bourne-ish. And, I do think of myself as Jason Bourne sometimes, but the truth is that, you know, Matt Damon might be a little bit better looking than I am. Just a little.
Yeah. And that's the thing about this. Once you understand the cues to look for, once you understand the behaviors, you don't have to look over your shoulder all the time. You will recognize it. You'll see it and you'll know how to respond.
Yep. All right. I'll take over next. This one's a fun one for me, because I honestly, I'm in the Apple ecosystem and I have no qualms with that. Like I've, as a matter of fact, one of the things that I use that I was going to show is my Apple AirTag. I use that whenever I'm putting, you know, luggage and checking that into an airplane. And it's a good thing too, because I had one of my bags got, I was coming back from Europe, that trip I was telling you about in Europe, and I was going back to Thailand, and my bag got stuck in Finland of all places. Cause I was traveling around about, and it spent a month going all around France before I was finally able to get them to send it back to me. And I was able to track it the whole time. They would tell me, oh no, it's at the airport. It's like, no, it's not. It's literally right now driving from Paris to this other place. And so, yeah, I like using these. I don't always keep one on me. That's a little bit different. I don't necessarily want people to be able to track me. However, I think that using trackers in certain situations, I've got one in my guitar case. So I always know where that will be. But That wasn't what I was trying to come up with. The reason I brought that up is because I don't keep all of my notes in like an iPad. Like, and I also didn't like the writing experience of an iPad. So I don't know if you've ever seen this before. This is called a Remarkable. Have you ever seen this, Andy?
Yes, I want one of those. Do you like it?
I love it. I really
okay.
And there's a couple of reasons. One, like the writing experience is just really, really nice for me. But the other thing is like it's digital, and there's things that I can do from a digital perspective that I like. I can sign documents. I can fill out PDFs if I just send them over. But for the most part, this thing remains off the grid. Like it's not connected to the internet. It's not connected to my computer unless I plug it in and plug it into my computer. I think you can do, you could do it wireless if you wanted to, but I just like being able to plug it in. And so that way I know that the notes that I'm taking when I'm having a conversation or when I'm, you know, brainstorming or stuff like that, it's on that device. And it's just one of those extra little ways that I try to keep myself from being 100% dependent upon, you know, Apple, Facebook, Google. I'm not one of those that goes 100% off. You know, I know there are people that are just like, I've got to be done with Google, or I've got to be nothing Apple. Everything's got to be done with Apple. Like I've got my Apple iPhone and I use it. I like it. I'm fine with it. But there are things that I do to try to make sure that they don't have everything. I don't use Apple Keychain. I use a separate, password manager. I don't use Safari. I use Brave. I don't use the Apple iPad to take notes. I use my Remarkable, and it's been great. Yeah, I love it.
Yeah, I clicked on it once on Instagram. So yeah. I keep seeing the ads for it over and over again. Oh, yeah. So I'm glad to see that you like it and you use it. I think another part of that is you just don't get distracted by the other apps on your device. Yeah. That's just it. Because I'm like, ooh, something shiny just appeared. You know, I'm going to go check this out. And the next thing you know, I've been scrolling through, you know, Instagram for 40 minutes. And I'm like, oh, where did all my productivity go? So yeah, that's awesome.
You know, side benefit is something else I've noticed is that a lot of times, let's say you're at a talk and somebody's talking, or you're on a phone call and somebody's like, you want to take notes on that. The difference between somebody seeing you on a computer or on your phone versus watching me write, there's a little bit of a respect level where I know for myself personally, if I see someone writing something down, they're taking notes about what I'm saying. You don't just, you know, doodle in the middle, like some people would, I'm sure. But I think there, to me, it's a little bit of a respect level whenever I'm having a phone call with somebody and I want to take notes on it. They're like, oh, hold on. I'll tell them. I'm going to write that down real quick. Instead of, you know, being on my computer typing where who knows, maybe I'm responding to an email while they're talking, you know? So I like that part of it.
Very good.
All right. Andy, you got anything else for us?
I've got one last thing here. And this thing sits on my desk all the time. Okay. Except for today, because my son used it. So I have another box. Unfortunately, I got to show you. This is for parents. This is a Troomi phone. I absolutely love this device. This is a smartphone for kids. And what this is, it's an actual Android phone with Troomi's operating system installed on it. And you can choose what apps are in their approved app library, that sort of thing. But one of the apps that they do not allow on their operating system is anything social media. So if you want your kids to be able to have a smartphone and then not have access to social media or not have access to every single website that's out there in the world, a Troomi phone can help do that. It's a great way to kind of step your kids into smart technology. So you can see all the text messages that they send. You can look at the GPS to see where they are. You can see their battery life, their signal, all that sort of stuff. You can call them. You can call and text from any app. You don't have to go into like a Troomi app and do that. There's a parent portal, but you can just call straight from your phone. I have found it to be really good for my son. Like he took off today and went and played basketball with one of his friends who lives in our neighborhood. And I was like, okay, here, just take the Troomi phone with you and go. He doesn't, there's no apps on it to play or anything like that. So he's unfortunate. He's not like me where he's like in his phone a bunch. And another thing is we call it the Troomi phone. We don't call it his phone. So he doesn't feel like he's entitled to have it all the time. So just one of these really cool things that I like. So there's a couple companies out there that do it, but I've had a Troomi phone and I've been using it probably for 4 months now. And it's always done everything. It's on AT&T's network. So it's always got a real strong signal and data works and all that sort of stuff.
Oh, that's really helpful. Yeah, we're gonna be going back to see family this summer. And that's one thing we've talked about with my now sixth grader going to be going on into, middle school is like all of his friends have phones, it feels like. And my wife and I are just debating about like, it's just not, he's already like, he's got a Chromebook that he has for school, and it's already, I'm having to monitor that thing like a hawk just to make, 'cause it's like, oh, you're doing homework. And I look over and he's really good already at switching windows. And it's like, oh,
Okay.
no.
Yeah.
We don't do that. And so, just being able to have something, I've thought about getting him one of those dumb phones, like an old Nokia or something.
Yeah, that's fine too.
But yeah, like I'll have to look into this Troomi thing because, like I said, we're going to be back in the US and it's easier to get that kind of stuff when we're in the States as opposed to overseas. So interesting. All right. Yeah, I think if you wanted to, we can transition now for a moment. I don't know if you have anything to add here, but I'm going to add like things that I don't use,
Sure.
which is kind of an interesting kind of switch on this, because here we've been talking about all the different devices that we do use. One of the things that I have, at least for now, I'm not going to say never, but for now, I've been able to keep from using is any kind of home video monitoring system. And I'll be honest, I've been approached. I don't know if you get approached, Andy, a lot, but I've been approached by a lot of companies that are like, hey, we'll send you a whole system, we'll for free, and we'll, help you install it and all that stuff. And I just have like the problem, I've got a little bit of a history with China, the country where a lot of this stuff is made. And so I'm not like, I'm already kind of on high alert for that stuff. But anything that connects video in the internet is just really, really hard for me. And I've tried to look for solutions that can just be done on like a local NAS or something, a network attached storage. But even then, I'm not like that network attached storage would still be connected to the internet. And so I would have trust issues as to whether or not that video would be transmitted and brought elsewhere. And I don't like the idea of cameras in my house. Definitely not in. I could see maybe outside the house, maybe. But even then, it's a little bit of a I don't go there. I don't know. What about you?
I think surveillance cameras for your house can be done, can definitely be overdone. I'm with you. I don't think they should be inside your house. I have seen stories from, there was one in Tennessee a couple of years back where this kid hacked into a Ring camera because somebody had used like the default password. This wasn't a super hacker or anything. It was just people being lazy. And the kid had access to a camera that it was in a little girl's room. It was right around Christmas time. So he starts talking to the girl and she's like, who are you? Whatever. And he says, I'm Santa Claus. And she just starts screaming, Oh, and it sounded like a teenager, just like, oh, look what I found. I'm just gonna do this. I don't think he was, his intent was to do something really bad. I think he just stumbled into it. But yeah, I'm with you with the whole concern about where your stuff comes from, where it's going, who has access to it. I totally get that. So yeah, I don't think security cameras inside the house is a good idea. I do think they're okay to have them outside. They can actually be a deterrent at some level. You can also make sure that they can turn on and off when you want to, that sort of thing. I'll throw this out for your consideration. There is a thing called a light bulb camera. And what this is a pan tilt zoom camera that screws into a standard light bulb, and you could put it like over your front door where your porch light goes. And this is a camera that just shoots straight down or can pan around just a little bit, but they can connect to a network or they can just record directly to an SD card. So if you did have a concern that you were worried about, you could just put that thing up there temporarily, take it down every couple of days and get that SD card out and look at the footage on your device. It doesn't have to go to a network or anything like that. And then if you don't feel
Interesting.
like you need it anymore, you could just put the old light bulb back in. So yeah, it's kind of an old like spy trick there. You just put the camera out there and leave it, and then you go retrieve it every once in a while just to take a look at what's going on.
I think that's a good point because I could see that if I was leaving the house, let's say going on a vacation, it's like, oh, well, actually, I wouldn't mind having cameras, then. And so there are certain things that make sense. I want to tell a quick story, my own personal story related to that. But before I do, I did want to say to everybody that's watching right now, we've got about 10 minutes left. I want to do a Q&A. So if you've got any questions related to what we've done here, or even if you just want to ask an unrelated question, go ahead and put that question in and we'll try to answer those as much as we can. All right, here's my story. I have a friend who served in the military. And so he would be overseas and, you know, probably in the Middle East somewhere. I don't know if I ever even knew where he was at. And the way that he and his wife, you know, set it up is he had the camera in their little son, like he, I think he was 1 or 2 years old. And he was a prankster. And every time that she would go in there to go take care of the baby, as long as he was awake, like he wouldn't wake up his son or anything, but he, because it's a talk back. And that just freaks me out that you could have somebody that can just talk, you know, to you through the camera. It's almost like an always on FaceTime or something. Yeah. But he would freak his wife out every time she walked in there and just be like, what are you doing? Or, you know, just like talking to her. And it was really funny. But at the same time, it was also eye-opening to me. It's like, oh, that's right. Great. That's great. I'm never putting that in my house.
Yeah. I'll tell you, here's a funny story. So I had a security camera through a home security service that doesn't exist anymore. And I was having problems with the camera. It was late at night. And I think I'd actually gone to bed and I got up because I was worried about it. So I called into customer service. And the camera was out in the garage. And so I had gone out to take a look at it, and I'm in my pajamas, and I'm talking to the tech on the phone, and she's like, yeah, I can see your camera. It's up and running now. And I realized she had seen me in my pajamas, just a few minutes prior looking at the camera. So it was a lesson to me that yes, this footage is captured and you can see it on your phone, but also the employees of that company can also see the footage. So that's why I really encourage people, don't put them inside your house, because there's a couple of companies who have gotten in trouble for not securing, you know, servers with footage on it, or making special servers for just people to see odd things that got shared outside of the company, that sort of thing. So Yeah.
We got somebody that comes in, says, lucky you weren't nude. And I think,
lucky for everybody.
Yeah. I also wanted to come in and say, we had someone just came here to say, I love your work. Thank you so much. I really appreciate all of you that have been supportive over the years, whether you're new as a subscriber or whether you've been around for a while. Really, really appreciate that. And hopefully now that you've met Andy, you'll go and check out his podcast, The Secure Dad. So that's just a plug here. I'll let you say something at the end as well. But if you guys if you listen to podcasts, just go and search for The Secure Dad and it'll come up. It's available on all the different podcast players. All right. Let's go through some of the questions. We're already getting a few of them. Some of the questions I honestly, like we were getting questions about IPFS, which is the interplanetary filing system or file system. I have no clue. Honestly,
I need to do
a lot of research before I go in and try to pretend asking any of those questions. With one key, would you back up the passwords on it to a password manager? So for those of you who weren't around at the very beginning, I was talking, did I say one key? It's only key. Yeah. So they wrote in one key, but it's actually only key. Any type of physical password manager, as a matter of fact, I'd say any password manager, anywhere where you're keeping passwords, I would recommend having some kind of backup somewhere. Now, you're only as strong as your least secure backup. Right. So if the whole reason you're using an only key to have a physical password manager is so that you don't store it in a password manager on the cloud, then going and backing it up in a password manager just doesn't make sense. The truth is you can't keep a whole lot of passwords on a physical password manager. And so, you know, even just writing it down and putting it in a safe or keeping it somewhere in a different location, I would say that would be better, unless you had a password manager like KeePass or something like that, that you had only a local file vault. So you're not having that uploaded to the cloud. Again, I'm assuming if you're using something like this, there's a reason. You've got a threat model that doesn't allow you to use a regular password manager. So that would be my thoughts on that. Do you have anything you wanted to add, Andy?
No, I think you've covered that really well.
Okay. Let's see, Andy, I don't know, this is kind of a little bit we're on the edge of my expertise and knowledge. I didn't know if you had anything that you have you dealt much with crypto?
No, I've read about it, so I don't have any personal experience with it or anything like that. I just know that I feel personally, I wouldn't put all my eggs in that basket. And I don't think that, you know, Josh here probably is going to say that either. I just, you know, if you're going to diversify your income, you're going to diversify your savings, that sort of thing, I would just make sure that whatever you have in cryptocurrency, if you lose it, you lose it, because it may not be your fault. You know, that sort of thing. It may be that the currency collapses, that sort of thing.
Yeah. And when it comes to privacy, I've actually, as of this last week, believe it or not, I finally got everything back. Not everything. Let me rephrase that. I got my fraction of what I got from being part of the Celsius bankruptcy. So I learned my lesson, and a centralized exchange has its risks. And, you know, not only from a privacy standpoint, but even from a business standpoint, I lost more money than I care to count on the fact that I had decided to store a lot of my Bitcoin with Celsius, and they gave back fractions of what I had stored in there. And it was very painful to see. At least I got something, I guess, but that I learned a little bit of the hard way on that. Let's see here. Andy, I didn't know you'd kind of mentioned, do you know off the top of your head, can you tell me the name of that camera that you were talking about? Because somebody's asking, are there any trustworthy and reliable options for something like Ring cameras?
Honestly, if you go with Ring, if you go with Blink, if you go with Nest, you're probably going to be okay. The bigger companies are going to be fine. They've got the better things. My deal is if you go onto Amazon and there's this this name of a company that you can't pronounce, I wouldn't necessarily trust that particular brand. Just go for the big ones, that sort of thing. And you're probably going to be okay there.
Yeah. Again, just being careful about where you put those. Right. Can VoIP numbers help combat spam calls? For those of you who don't know, VoIP being voice over internet protocol. So instead of using your actual telephone app, you're using something like Skype or Google Voice or something like that. I will say I migrated my, so at one point is actually when I moved overseas, I took the phone number that I did have that had somehow gotten on a whole bunch of these lists, and I migrated that over to Google Voice. And then I bought another number through something called Hushed. And then I've been testing another one called Cloaked, which is really fascinating to me. But I now never give out my actual phone number, the phone number that rings this phone, to anybody except a friend or like a really close friend or a my family, right? And that does two things. First of all, it has eliminated, I don't get spam calls, or I do get spam calls. They're all to my virtual numbers,
right?
And tons of texts and spam calls and stuff like that. But I've reduced it to just that one number and made sure that that number, that app, doesn't have the ability to send me notifications or pings or anything like that. On the flip side, I also manage my notifications by how, and hopefully my friends around here won't see this, but I basically, they don't know this, but the app that I give you to communicate with me will in the background tell you how much I want to actually hear from you. So if you get my phone number,
you're not answering my calls, Josh, is that it?
Like the closest is if you have my phone number, right? If you can text me, that will always come through as a notification for me, because I want my wife to be able to text me. And I want people to be able to, like my parents, to be able to get to me at any point in time. But I'm very, very strict about who gets that phone number. So then it depends. Do you get Signal? Do you get WhatsApp? Do you get Facebook? Facebook Messenger means I'll check that once a day, right? And so you may not hear back from me for 24 hours. So like, that's one of the ways I manage that. And, you know, because there's different levels of spam. Like there's spam, and I don't want to call a friend's text spam, but we get messaged all the time. And I think that notifications can be spam. And so I want to control like the actual bot spam. And then I want to just control what I would consider be notification spam. All right, let's continue. I didn't know if you had anything else you wanted to add to that.
No, the only thing there is I do kind of the same thing with email addresses. I have an email address that I use for everything else, and then I have a private one that is a Proton Mail email address that I use just for family communication. So I don't sign up for accounts with this address. It is simply for communicating with the people who are most important to me.
Yep. We had somebody ask, would you recommend YubiKey? I actually have two of these right here. I was thinking about showing, but I was like, oh, I talk about YubiKey all the time. Yes, I recommend YubiKey. Hands down, my favorite kind of 2FA option. I've used a number of them. OnlyKey has a similar, you know, 2FA key, but I prefer and exclusively use YubiKey. And then somebody else asked, is Ledger a honeypot? I get asked a lot about, like, is such and such a honeypot? And it's really, it's problematic for me because especially with my position and having somewhat of a, I hate to even call it an influencer type of, you know, like, but there's people that are watching this and I can't say with certainty that anything is or isn't a honeypot because I would hate to, you know, have told people, hey, this is the best thing. You know, I trust certain companies because of the fact that I've, you know, like YubiKey being an example, I get questions about, hey, is YubiKey a honeypot? I don't think so. I can't be 100% certain, but I've visited their offices. I've met the people, I've used their product, and I don't think so. Same with Ledger. I mean, like, I don't know for sure, but I don't think so. I don't know if you had anything you wanted to add to that.
No, I mean, I think, you know, the one time I say, hey, this one definitely is 100% safe, that's going to end up being the honeypot one. So that's just Murphy's Law for me. So yeah, I just be cautious with whatever you do with whatever company, you know?
Yeah. Well, Andy, before we jump off, first of all, for everybody that has joined us live, thank you so much for being here. I love being able to kind of look through at the comments and the conversations that are happening. I hope that this is always fun and enjoyable for all of you. I want to give you, Andy, a moment to just kind of share what's going on in your world and about your book and your podcast. Before I do that, I wanted to say thank you again to DeleteMe for sponsoring this live stream. Like we've said before, both Andy and I have used DeleteMe. Andy's been using it, gosh, for now almost 6 years, it sounds like. So he's got even more experience than I do. So if you want to find out more about them, go to joindeleteme.com/allthingssecured. If you want to help support this, or you can just go to joindeleteme.com. I'll never know the difference, but I appreciate their support and I appreciate your support as well. So Andy, why don't you send us off by letting us know a little bit more about your Secure Dad stuff?
Sure. So if you go to thesecuredad.com, that is everything about me. I do have a podcast that I put out every Wednesday where I have people come and talk about home security, situational awareness, online privacy, and things like that. It's a lot of fun to be able to sit down and talk to cool people like Josh. And also thank you to DeleteMe for giving us this opportunity to talk. But the book is Home Security, The Secure Dad's Guide. It is available exclusively at Amazon. And you can find out pretty much everything about me at thesecuredad.com. Follow me on X and Instagram with the username The Secure Dad.
Awesome. Thank you, Andy. Thank you to everybody else who has been joining us today. It, as always, it is a pleasure to get to connect with you guys. And I've got another live stream coming up next month. I honestly can't even remember. I've got somebody scheduled. I think it's Tech Lore. I think I'm going to be sitting down with Tech Lore next month. So that's the first time that we've done any kind of collaboration. So I'm really looking forward to that. Be on the lookout. I could pull up. Let me see if I can pull up my calendar and let you know when that's going to be. That's going to be a lot of fun. And I'm not even sure exactly what that is. It's going to be on the 17th in the US time. So March 17th, I'm going to be with Henry with Tech Lore, and I'm really excited about that. So please make sure you join us for that. And if you have any other questions, you're always welcome to contact me, contact@allthingssecured, or a better way, honestly, is to get on Twitter, @all_secured, /X, whatever, Twitter X, and we can talk there. You guys have a great rest of your evening or day, depending on what time it is for you, and take care. Stay safe.